for our Lord Jesus Christ. Shall we welcome again Reverend Alan Shaw, our missionary to Malaysia and Pakistan. Let's clap our hands to Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, and we're so happy to be here again, feeling this wonderful presence of the Lord. I feel very moved in my spirit. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Yesterday, I received the Holy Ghost 56 years ago, January 18, 1961. But I still feel a fresh touch of the Holy Ghost today. And I don't want to ever lose that. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. I've been very stirred by the messages that I have heard today. First of all, from our regional director, Brother Buckland, and then also from your general superintendent, Brother Bodegas. Praise God. These are real men of God. They are men who have an understanding of the times, who have an understanding of what needs to be done in this day and age. And I'm so thankful for leadership like that. Sister Shaum and I were appointed to a dual appointment to Malaysia and Pakistan. We had been in Pakistan for 30 years, but we wanted to turn the work to the National Brethren there, and we felt like they were ready for that, and felt like we needed to begin a broader-based ministry. So we moved to Malaysia, and we are helping there, but we also felt like we could make ourselves available to others in the Asia and the Pacific regions, and the Global Missions Board said that we were free to do that. And in the last 5 years, we have preached in at least 20 countries, some of them many times, and the Lord has opened many doors for us. I knew that the Philippines was in this region, but I thought I would probably never end up here because you folks get the best preachers. You've already seen a great revival, and my ministry has been to go to small works and areas that are facing difficulty and try and help them to break things open. But then I remembered the scripture and I received the invitation to come, and I remembered the scripture in Romans chapter 1. The Apostle Paul had been to many places, but he wrote to the church at Rome and he said, "For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end that you may be established." All of us has a little bit of something that maybe nobody else has, and it can help complete the picture. And so I'm so thankful the Lord allowed us to be here. You folks have ministered to us. We have loved and appreciated the opportunity of being here. And thank you. I do want to thank the Executive Board and General Superintendent, Brother Bodegas, for that invitation. I want to thank Brother Buckland and Sister Buckland for their leadership in this region. We've grown to really love and appreciate them. They are spiritual people and have the heart of God. And I appreciate that. I'm so thrilled for the messages that we've heard from our evening evangelist, Brother Flowers. I met him, the first time I met him was at Christmas of 1970. I had come home to attend Bible college in Canada, and his brother, Brother David Flowers, was in Bible school with me. My parents were missionaries in India at the time. We didn't have cell phones and FaceTime and Skype and all those kind of things in that day. And so in the year and a half that I spent before I was able to get back to India to visit my family, I had 1 3-minute telephone call. They were in a city where there was a telephone, and they booked a call, and I spoke to them for 3 minutes. By the time I said hello to each of my mother and father and two brothers, the call was already over. But that's the only contact that I had. And so the Flowers said, "Well, where are you going for Christmas?" "Well, I don't know." Said, "Come and join us in Tennessee." And so I had a wonderful time getting to meet them down there. Praise God. I want to give honor to all the missionaries here, the pastors. You've done a great work in this nation and around the world. To the saints of God, you're a part of this church. It's a live and active church. And you're a part of it, and I appreciate that. Praise God. Praise God. The music has been absolutely superlative. Praise God. Top shelf. You can't go anywhere in the world and get better music than we've heard in this conference. And I want to thank them for that, and I felt the spirit coming from them too. It wasn't done with a spirit of pride, but it was a spirit of humility and service, and we thank you for that. Praise God. Praise God. Well, while you're still standing here, we're going to turn in our Bibles this morning to the book of Zechariah chapter 2. I had three different subjects that have been circulating in my mind for today, and I, after the session yesterday, went home and began to pray and to meditate, and again this morning, last night after service, and there were just three different things, and I've learned that usually when you get to the service, the Lord's going to say, okay, this is where the Rolodex stops, and so here we are. After I heard your superintendent's message and the vision that he has, I felt this is the direction the Lord would have us go. Zechariah chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. I lifted up mine eyes again and looked, and behold, a man with a measuring line in his hand. Then said I, "Whither goest thou?" And he said unto me, "To measure Jerusalem, to see what is the breadth thereof, and what is the length thereof." And behold, the angel that talked with me went forth, and another angel went out to meet him, and said unto him, "Run, speak to this young man, saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls, for the multitude of men and cattle therein. For I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire round about, and will be the glory in the midst of her." I'd like to speak for a few minutes this morning on the subject, walls of fire. Praise God. Lord Jesus, we thank you again for your presence in this place, for the way that you have come into this conference to meet with your people. We're asking now again for the anointing of the Holy Ghost to flow freely. Give us a spirit of revelation and understanding. Lord, open our eyes to see what you have for the church. And we ask these things in the name which is above every name. In Jesus' name we pray. And let's glorify him one more time if you want to see him. Ancient cities used to have thick walls built around them for protection. Some of the walls were so thick The walls of Jericho, they tell us, were wide enough they could have actually held chariot races on them. And they built those walls because in those days there were marauding armies that would come through from time to time and try to loot the different cities. There were thieves, bands of thieves that would come and attack. And so they had these huge walls built to protect the city. In the daytime, the gates would be open, and people could go in and out. Farmers, if they had croplands outside the walls, they would go there and work in the daytime. There would be traders that would be passing through the area who could come in and trade their goods. But at nighttime, the gates of the walls were shut. There was no ability for anyone to come in and to go out. I understand a little bit about this because in India and in Pakistan, where I was raised, they are very old civilizations, and they have forts, some of them that were started 2,000 years ago. The city of Lahore, which started around the time of Christ, has a huge fort built there, and the gates are so enormous that elephants can easily pass through. That's how some of the warriors rode, and the kings would come in on these elephants riding into the city. I've been there, and it's quite an impressive thing. They had very impressive palaces. Some of the rooms were made from small pieces of glass, and when you walked in, they would have candles and lights, and the shimmering light would be very, very startling and amazing. They had a lot of beautiful things in there. And there was one problem, however, with a city that was built of stone like that. It's very difficult to expand. When you have walls built of stone, you can't just say, well, we need to knock this down and build, because if it's 5 or 10 meters wide, you've got a lot of fill and wall to remove. And so it makes it very, very difficult. It's not impossible, but it's very, very difficult to expand when you have a city surrounded with a huge stone wall. But Zechariah said, I had a vision, and when I lifted up my eyes again, I looked, and behold, there was a man with a measuring line in his hand. And I said, where are you going? And he said, I'm going to measure Jerusalem to see what is the breadth, how wide it is, and what is the length of that city. He said, I'm supposed to see how big this city is. And then an angel, the angel that talked with him, went, and another angel came and said to him, and run and speak to this young man, saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls, for the multitude of men and cattle therein. He said, the day is coming when the walls of the city of Jerusalem will not be able to contain all of those who need to inhabit the place. The humans and the cattle and the other things that are coming in, these walls will be too small. I'm just checking them right now to see what the size is, so that we'll know how much growth comes in the future, so we'll be able to understand what God has done for us.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. I believe that the Lord has a plan for the last days that's going to blow the mind of the church. I believe He's getting ready to do something in this day and age that we can hardly imagine. The United Pentecostal Church in the Philippines, as far as I can understand, is probably the largest overseas work. I asked, and somebody said, you have about 460,000 believers. That's huge. That's amazing. But then I heard somebody say today that the population of this country is 103 million. So that means we still have some work to do. There's still some things that need to happen. We've got some nice solid walls built of doctrine that we need. We've got some solid walls that will protect us against the onslaught of the enemy and from marauding armies that go through. But the problem is, just keeping those walls in cement where they are is not enough. We've got to push back the walls for the revival that's coming. We've got to allow that city to expand so that all those out there that we're trying to reach can also become inhabitants of the city. This is not a club that we're in. You and me, us four and no more. But it's a city that God is building. He wants a city that's going to expand so that many from every kind of ethnicity can come and become a part of it. Praise God. Praise God. Well, you say, if you remove the walls, and nowadays most of our cities around the world don't have walls. Sister Shalman and I moved to Karachi in the year 1982. And at that time, the population was around, if I remember correctly, 9 or 10 million. Today, they have 24 million. The city has expanded enormously. The population of the country was 93 million. Today, it's 200 million. And so things are moving rapidly. Populations are growing around the world. And the church has to do something to impact the world. But if we have a stone wall mentality, we will not be able to reach the world. Yes, we must keep our doctrine. Yes, there are certain principles that we cannot allow to go. But if you're going to remove the stone walls, what's going to be there to replace it? Replace it so that we can have protection. Verse 5, for I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire round about, and will be the glory in the midst of her. The Lord said, I'm going to replace the stone wall with a wall of fire. And anything that is impure will be burned up if it tries to go through the fire to attack my church. I will protect them now with fire. And the wonderful thing about fire is it doesn't have to be contained in one place, but it can expand rapidly. There can be protection for everyone inside that wall because fire burns with a consuming flame. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anything that is not of God that attacks the city will burn up in the fire. There will be those that come against the church. There will be those who will mock the church. But the Lord will continue to expand it. Praise God. There is nothing that can stop the church today. There is nothing that can stop God from accomplishing His purpose in the earth. In Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 8, chapter 9 and verse 8, the Lord said, and I will encamp about mine house because of the army, because of him that passeth by, and because of him that returneth, and no oppressor shall pass through them anymore, for now I have seen with mine eyes. In the New Living Translation of the Bible, it says, I will guard my temple and protect it from invading armies. I am watching closely to ensure that no more foreign oppressors overrun my people's land. What the Lord was saying is, I'm going to become the wall of protection. Up until now, you built it. But now I'm going to be that wall of protection, and nothing can harm my church. Praise God. Praise God. You know, I was born and raised in India, and as a boy, when I heard that scripture, Jesus saying, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In my mind, I had this picture, that the devil was chasing me, and I was just keeping one step ahead of him. And then one day it occurred to me, because now, at that time we were living in Pakistan, every home in that nation has a wall built around it. That's to keep out the beggars, the stray dogs, the cows roaming through the streets, whatever else it is, they have gates and walls there to protect them. And it suddenly struck me, those gates and walls were built to protect the people inside. I have never seen an offensive gate in my life. I never saw a gate jump off of its hinges and start chasing somebody down the road. Those gates were to protect those who were inside from what might come from outside. The devil built some gates of hell to protect the passage, the prisoners that he had inside. He knew that an attack was coming on his kingdom one day. He is the one who can't really move. It's the church that's got the wall of fire around it that's going to be able to move and attack the gates of hell. And Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We're going to take down spiritual strongholds so that the prisoners can be free and they can become a part of this city of fire. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Wall of fire can expand rapidly. That's why you can see revival impact even entire nations very quickly. I read some time ago, and I don't know which area it was, but it said there was some islands in the Pacific that when a missionary arrived there, there were no Christians. When he died, there were no heathen. I believe God wants to impact entire nations. I'm not talking about a revival in a local church. I'm not talking about a revival in a particular state or province. I'm not talking about a revival in a nation even. I believe God is going to send a massive revival around the world that's going to turn this world upside down. In Exodus chapter 14, Exodus the 14th chapter, Israel had left the land of Egypt and they were on their way to the promised land. They had barely left Egypt and the news came that Pharaoh's army was behind them. They had changed their minds and didn't want to lose their slaves, so they were coming after them. They had a problem now, Israel did. The Red Sea was in front of them. Mountains were on two sides, and the Egyptian army was behind them. The Israelites had been slaves for more than 400 years. They weren't soldiers. They didn't know how to fight. They couldn't protect themselves. And so Moses went to the Lord, and it tells us in Exodus chapter 14 and verse 19, and the angel of the Lord, which went before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of the cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. You see, the Lord had been guiding them with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And when the enemy came in, the Lord sent that cloud and the angel of the Lord behind them to separate them from the enemy that was coming after them. When you've got a flexible wall, you can put it wherever you need it at the time you need it. It had been leading and guiding them, but in a time of danger, that wall moved right behind them, between them and the Egyptians, and gave them the protection that they needed. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud and darkness to them, to the Egyptians. But it gave light by night to those of the Israelites, so that the one came not near the other all the night. You may be in the night time right now, in your church, your life, your ministry. Whatever it is, the Lord is on your side. And he will set a wall of fire around you to protect you from the enemy. When you're going to the promised land, you will be attacked from time to time. But the Lord has promised that he would give you protection. In the book of 2 Kings, reading in chapter 6, the story is told of how the king of Syria decided to lay an ambush against the Israelites, or the king of Israel, and he planned it 2 or 3 times, and each time the Israelite king seemed to be aware of his plans and avoided the trap. Finally, the Syrian king called his counselors together, and he said, "One of you is a traitor. You're letting the king of Israel know our plans." And they said, "No, no, no, sir, that's not the case. There's a prophet in Israel, and he's the one who is telling the king of Israel what is happening and about our plans." And so the scripture tells us that the king of Syria then gathered together his armies. He gathered together his chariots, and he went after this prophet. I want you to know, as a child of God, you are far more powerful than you understand. When the enemy gets upset, he has to send a whole army and a whole bunch of chariots, that goes with the tanks of their day. He has to send all of his weaponry to capture one man who is not a soldier. Talking about a coward. He felt like, I can't come against this man just with a few soldiers. I've got to send my whole army after him. And so when the servant of the prophet woke in the morning and he looked over the city, outside the walls, he saw the city was compassed about with horses and chariots. And he said to his master, "Alas, how shall we do? What are we going to do? Can you see all these chariots around us? All these horses, all these soldiers?" And the prophet Elisha said, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than that be with them." Just relax, man. We've got reinforcements that are far greater. And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." I wear glasses. The doctor told me many years ago that I am clinically blind in my left eye. In my right eye, when I look at you now, you are a sea of colors, but I cannot see individuals. I cannot see clearly. I have to put on my glasses so I can see you. And the Lord was simply Elisha was asking the Lord, Lord, would you give him spiritual specs, spiritual eyeglasses, so he can see things the way you and I see them. Lord, open his understanding. Let him understand that you are with us. And it said the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire. The Lord said, I will be a wall of fire about you. You don't have to be afraid. You don't need to be fearful. You can step out with faith and confidence, because I'm going to be there, and I'll be that wall of protection around you. Praise God. Praise God. In our revival times during in the nation of Pakistan, it seemed like every time we had a crusade, there was some major problem in the country. It's interesting, we're planning our first one in 7 years. The country was very much in a difficult position. We were in no position to have a crusade. We decided that we're going to have one in April. And the country, which has basically been quiet for almost 2 years, suddenly has erupted in suicide bombings again. That's the kind of thing that happens all the time. And I remember we were having a crusade in the city of Rawalpindi in October of 2007. Brother James Stark from Columbus, Ohio, Brother Eli Hernandez, Brother Doug Kleindens had come to preach in that crusade. And as our present general superintendent was checking, making last minute checks that everything was in order, he noticed that on the side where our pastors would be sitting, there was a wall. We were holding it in a large open ground owned by another church group. And he noticed that where the pastors were going to be sitting, there was no lighting arrangements. Now on three sides, there was very strong security. But on the one side, there was an orchard just back there. And it would be very easy for somebody to sneak in and take grenades or whatever they wanted to do and lob them into the ground. And so he mentioned to the people who were putting the place together for the meeting, he said, make sure you get lights there. Somehow they forgot. And when we came to service that night, there were no lights in the area where the pastors were sitting. It was darkened. That night, Brother Eli Hernandez was preaching, and as he preached, he was walking back and forth across the platform, and then suddenly, he turned in the direction, and he pointed just above where our pastors were sitting, and he said, I see two generals sitting there. He was referring to angels, and then he went on with his preaching. We saw 1,600 people receive the Holy Ghost in that crusade, and after the service, the next day, there was a suicide bomber that blew himself up at a checkpoint just outside the walls, and six people were killed. But the Lord had sent his angels to protect the people. Praise God. Praise God. He said, I'll be a wall of fire about you. You just expand the wall. You just keep moving. You keep evangelizing. You keep preaching. Don't stop where you are. I'll take care of you wherever you go. In 2011, the month of May, I had made arrangements to go and preach in an area where we didn't have any churches. It was in the tribal area. And we had sent several men in. They had not succeeded in breaking into that area with the gospel. But we had met some people who were running an orphanage, and they invited me to come and minister. And so I made arrangements with them, and we decided that we would come on the 5th of May. It was an arbitrary date. We could have chosen any date. It could have been the 30th of April or whatever, but we chose the 5th of May. At midnight of the 1st of May, early morning in the 2nd of May, the American military sent in Navy SEALs to take out Osama bin Laden. And it was right in the city where we were supposed to have been. Well, obviously, we didn't go on the 5th of May. It was very near the military complex there, and they were checking everything very closely. So we postponed the meeting for 2 weeks. When I arrived on the 18th of May to have the meeting, they were serving us some refreshments in the living room area. And they asked me, "Brother Sean, would you like to see Osama's house?" And I said, "Well, why not? Everybody in the world's talking about him right now." So they took me up on the rooftop. It was the house next door. There was just a small field in between, but it was the next house. And they said when the American military, the first helicopter crash landed, they blew it up because they didn't want the technology revealed. They said it actually blew the locks off the houses of our door. We could have chosen to go that night, and we would have been in serious trouble, because we could have been said to be spotters or something. But God sends His angel to protect us. We don't know where we're going, what time we're going to be there, what's happening next, but all we know is we've got a God who stands with us, and He builds a wall of fire around us. And when we're moving into new areas where it looks like there could be persecution or danger, if He's told us to go, He's going to send that wall with us. Praise God. Praise God. In Jeremiah chapter 33, okay, I've talked about the wall. Let's talk about moving out of the wall. Jeremiah chapter 33, beginning at verse 1. "Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah the second time, while he was yet shut up in the court of the prison, saying, Thus saith the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that hath formed it to establish it. The Lord is his name. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." Jeremiah was in a pit, prison. He was down under the ground in a place surrounded by four walls, and there was no way that he could get out on his own. I've heard stories related how he may have been knee-deep in mud. There would have been rats and vermin running around. Not a very pleasant situation. There were walls, stone walls, surrounding him. But in the midst of that condition, the Lord came and spoke to him and said, "Jeremiah, I want you to know that if you will call to me, I'm going to answer thee. I'm listening to you. And will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." You look at the prison and the walls around you, but I want you to lift up your head and call on me, because I'm going to show you things you can't even imagine right now. As your general superintendent was ministering, he talked about his humble beginnings, and that how one day he went to the 2-month Bible school. I don't think at that time you were feeling, "One day I'm going to be the general superintendent of the United Pentecostal Church in the Philippines." But he did have a voice, an ear that was sensitive to the Spirit, and the Lord told him to do some other things. And the Lord has shown him great and mighty things over the years. I believe every one of us has potential. The seed of potential is in our heart right now. And if we'll allow that to grow, if we'll call upon the name of the Lord, He will reveal things to us. He will show us things that we can't even imagine at this moment. One of my favorite scriptures is in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Paul said, "Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think." Most of us love to quote that first part. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly, above all we can ask or think. We know God's powerful. We know he's mighty. Well, but we like to leave it up there with him. But the key to that verse is not what God can do. That's already settled. The key to it is, what will we do with it? According to the power, not that resides in us, but that worketh in us. We've got to activate that spirit that's been placed in us. We've got to make it go to work, because then things will begin to happen. Then he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or think. The Lord gave me a very simple illustration, and I told you I'm a simple person, so he has to speak to me in language I can understand. But I want you to imagine here this morning, just go on a little journey with me. Supposing this morning there was an ant walking around on this pulpit, and somehow I was able to communicate with that ant, and so I would look at it and say, "Listen, ant, the world is a very big place." He would look up at me and say, "Well, yeah, it's big, but he said, I can get over there in just a minute or so. I can go up there. It's not that big." "Oh, but the world is much larger than that." He said, "Really?" I said, "Yeah, you want to go for a ride?" "Well, okay. Here, get on my finger and we're going for a ride." And so the ant climbs up on my hand. And I take him and I start to walk along the platform. And he's looking and says, "Wow, I never saw those flowers like that before. What are those round things?" "Well, those are balloons." "Oh, I've never seen anything like this." All of a sudden, his world has expanded. He's now seeing things that he couldn't imagine just a little while before. But I'm carrying him there. And then I said, "Well, if you think that's something, let me take you down and show you some people." And I start moving down here and moving in around the congregation. And that little ant is blown away. "Wow, I couldn't imagine this. It's beyond my thinking." I said, "Well, if you think that's something, just hang on for another hour or two. I'm going to drive through the streets of this city. We're going to go to a hotel that's a number of kilometers away from here." And he would see traffic and all those things. You see, he was used to living on the pulpit. That was his world. But now all of a sudden, everything's expanding. And then I tell him, in just a couple more days, I'm going to get on an airplane. And we're going to leave this island and fly to another island. And there's going to be a city, Manila. Somebody told me there's 24 million people there. Whew. Or maybe more than that, I don't know. And the ant is thinking, I can't hardly comprehend this. And then I tell him, "You just wait. Because next week on Thursday, I'm going to get on another airplane, and we're going to fly for 3.5 hours to another country. We're going to pass several countries on the way, and we're going to reach the nation of Kuala Lumpur. You're going to see different people there. You're going to see different situations. And if you'll hang with me for another week, a couple weeks, I'm going to get on another airplane and fly for 9 hours to Islamabad, Pakistan. And if you'll wait with me until the month of May, we'll get on another plane. We'll fly to the Middle East in Dubai, and then on to Brazil, across the other side of the world." What I'm talking about is expanding our vision, letting the walls of fire begin to move out. We've been moving around on the desk too long, and the Lord wants us to see the whole world. How many people do you think the Lord wants to see saved? Okay, people are saying all. That's good. Now let me put it in this way. In your community, how many people do you expect to get saved? If you had a community of 50,000 people and your church was 500, you think, man, I got a good church here. But there's still 49,500 that don't have the truth. What's 500 is only 1% of 50,000, is that right? I'm not good in mathematics, so you have to help me on those. But even if you thought 10%, no, 5,000 come to the Lord. That'd be great. That would be wonderful. And it would, because one soul is worth more than a whole world. But let me give you what the Scripture says about what the will of God is. Now, I'm not telling you Alan Shaw theory. I'm going to let you see what the Bible says about it. In John chapter 3 and verse 16, anybody ever heard of that scripture? Yeah. For God so loved the Philippines. Yes, he does. So when he went to Calvary, he only died for people from the Philippines. The rest of the world was. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It's the will of God. He died for the whole world. He didn't just die for you and me. He died for the whole world. He didn't die for people we like necessarily. He may have died for, he died for people that we may not like so well. But let's look at 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. 2 Peter 3 and 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish. He's not willing. So it's not the will of God that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It is the will of God that every person in this world be saved. Well, in the New Testament church, they began to preach the gospel, and through persecution it started to spread them to different countries and nations and cities. Most of them had to leave Jerusalem, and they went everywhere spreading the word. Remember that Jesus had told his disciples, go you into all the world and preach the gospel to how many creatures? To every creature. Now they didn't have airplanes to travel in those days, or cars, or three-wheelers, or whatever else we used to travel. They did not have newspapers, radios, television, the internet, or anything else that we use to spread information. When Sister Shalm and I first went to the field, we spoke to our parents once or twice in 4 years by phone. You had to book in advance, and finally after 3 days, they would call you back and say, okay, you can talk now. We had booked for 3 minutes, and a crow sat on the wire outside our home and broke the connection. So that's the way that we lived in those days. But now we see that in the days when they didn't have any modern technology, when things were very, very difficult, you might think that the Lord was just speaking euphemistically. He was just saying, well, go and reach the whole world. Really meaning get as many as you can. But I was startled one day when I read in the book of Colossians chapter 1 and verse 23. Colossians 1 and 23. Paul said, if you continue in the faith grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, have made a minister. He said, we have preached the gospel to every creature which was under heaven. They did it in their day without all of the things that we've got today. You know that what that tells me? We really haven't been doing our job. As much as we've seen, there is that much more to do again. And the Lord is challenging His church today to open our eyes and see the potential. He said, I'm willing to go wherever you go. When I call you, I'll go with you, and I'll be a wall of fire around you. But you've got to come with me. In 2002, I believe it was, we had been evacuated from Pakistan shortly after 9/11, and we were in Fredericton, Ontario, attending the church where Brother Raymond Woodward pastors. He had just taken the church a few months before we arrived, and they have an annual missions conference every November. And so because we were there, he asked if we would be a participant in that conference. And so we agreed to do that. I remember one service that we were sitting. I was sitting on the platform. And I opened my Bible to the scripture in Psalm 2 and 8. I was just, I don't know what caused me to do that. I maybe felt like maybe he's going to ask me to come and say it's something. I should have something ready. And so I was looking in my Bible and I saw this scripture in Psalm 2 and 8. And the Lord is speaking to His servant and He says, ask of me and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. When I read those words, it was like a fire came on my heart. From the time that I was a teenager, I had heard of the miracles that my mother and father had seen when they came into the church. They were saved in Western Canada, the province of Saskatchewan, in the early 1930s. But my mother told me that her elder sister, her sister was probably 14 years older than her, but she said her elder sister, Edna, had been stricken with leukemia. Blood cancer, and in those days they had no cure for it. And so a neighbor who attended the Pentecostal church said, you know, at our church we pray for the sick. Why don't you bring Edna? And I believe God can heal her. And so my mother's family went to the church that night. Most of them received the Holy Ghost. And I assume that Edna was healed because she did live for another 50 years. But through that, my mother's family came into the church. She told me in that one local congregation, they had service every night for 13 consecutive years. There was never a night where they didn't have church. Christmas, New Year's, it didn't matter when, they were having church. They would bring in an evangelist and he would preach for 6 weeks continuously. And then they would bring in a Bible teacher. And for the next 9 weeks, he would ground the people. And then they would start another round of evangelism. And then another round of teaching. And for 13 consecutive years, this continued. My mother said thousands of people across Western Canada were impacted by that one church. My father lived on a farm. His father was a farmer. And he was a little better off than some of the neighbors. He was the only man in the area who had a car. But a neighboring lady said, I've heard about a church down there and I've had this affliction. Would you kindly drive me? Now my grandfather at that time was a Baptist lay preacher and didn't believe in the Holy Ghost and gifts of the Spirit. But to be a good neighbor, he said, all right, I'll take you down there. And so my dad, being in the family, went with them and he received the Holy Ghost. He was 8 years old. My mom and dad actually met each other when they were just over 20 years of age, 12 years after both of them received the Holy Ghost. When they compared notes, they had received the Holy Ghost in the same month in the same church. But they didn't meet for 12 years because so many people were being impacted by that revival. And when my mother told me that, the fire started burning in my heart. I was only a young person, but I began praying even in school. Lord, I've read about the book of Acts. I've heard what my mom has talked about in revival, and I want to see that. And for over 25, maybe 30 years, I had prayed almost every day, Lord, let me see the day of Pentecost happen again. I told you yesterday when Brother Billy Cole came, 3,000 received it. And then when Brother Kleinens came again, another 3,000. But at this missions conference, as I was sitting there reading in Psalm 2 and 8, the Lord spoke to me almost in an audible voice. He said, Alan, for over 25 years you asked me to see 3,000 receive the Holy Ghost in a service. Now you've seen it happen twice. I didn't let you see it happen once. I've let you see it happen twice. And then came the startling thing. He said, now what do you want to see? He put absolutely no limitations on it. And I got kind of scared because numbers started going through my mind like this. And finally I grabbed one and I said, okay, 500 million. I have since repented. But I have asked the Lord now to give us 1 billion souls in the continent of Asia. At least, I want to see more than that. But at least 1 billion souls. I think the Philippines is going to be a huge part of that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. I've already thought 1 billion. That means he can do way beyond what I've asked for. He's promised us the heathen for our inheritance. The farthest corners of the earth are for the church. We need to wake up and go and get them. Wherever we go, the wall of fire is going to surround us. Wherever we go. Can I say this in as kind a way as I possibly can? Giving you folks a few compliments. Now let me say this, because I heard a little bit from your superintendent, so I got a little bit of courage. But you folks are fantastic at reaching other Filipinos. You're doing it all around the world. I've been in Singapore. Brother Doji and Sister Nancy are here. We were there about 2 years ago. They had 1,600 Filipinos in their church, in their local church. Well, they can't all meet at once because the building's not big enough, but that's part of their congregation. You folks are doing an amazing job reaching your own people. But you have an ability to go into nations that Americans and Canadians can't get into. You can get into homes of some of the most influential people in the world. Sister Sean met a Filipina in the UK.
She had worked in the home of the lady who was in charge of CNN in the UK. She traveled all over the world with her. You get a chance to talk to people that would never hear the gospel any other way. Don't be satisfied moving around on the desk, but start looking out there. You can impact this whole world. God was letting you practice on your own people, but now you have confidence. Start reaching out to the rest of the world. There are islands all the way through the Pacific here that need missionaries. God will take care of the finance. My mom and dad went to India. They were promised $50 a month for living and work expenses and travel expenses. That was in 1949, when $50 was a little more than it is now. That came in, they said, an average of once every 3 months. 2 months, the money didn't come in. My dad walked all over the hills of South India, sleeping on the ground, sleeping on cement floors and schoolhouses, taking and preaching the gospel. But today, in the nation of India, there's probably close to 150,000 believers. He didn't do it all, but the Lord does work through us if we'll take this gospel. It's time to move out. Praise God. I've lived among people that were not my own almost my whole life. I was born and raised in India. I've lived in Pakistan. I'm living in Malaysia. I'm traveling throughout Asia and the Pacific. And the reason that I'm doing it, the thing that's thrusting me forward, is Jesus said, and preach the gospel to every creature. You are a dynamic church. You've got a power that most United Pentecostal churches don't have. You've got something already here. Now you need to take it with you and reach the world. He'll take care of it. You may struggle from time to time, but the wall of fire will always be there. You don't have to be fearful.
Praise God. Sorry, I've taken more time than I intended. I don't know how you see yourselves, but I see you as mighty warriors.
Hallelujah.
I see you as mighty men and women of God. I see unlimited potential in this church. Hallelujah. You have a strong, mature leadership. Men that know the Word of God well. You've got a strong pastoral body. People that have given themselves to preach the gospel. You've got saints who know the Word of God well. And that's why they're teaching in different countries and places that they go. But now the Lord is saying, it's time to move to a new paradigm. It's time to get off the desk and to start moving out into the world. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I don't know a church anywhere in the world more than this church that has the capability of doing that. I'll tell you frankly, America has money, but they don't have the kind of people that you have in their churches. There are some exceptions. There are exceptions. But you've got a spirit in you that drives you to take the gospel. And if you'll rise and go in the name of Jesus, you don't have to feel like second-class citizens. God has equipped you to do things nobody else can do. And I'm telling you that as a Canadian. My country is suffering. It needs to hear the gospel. And thank God we have some Filipino missionaries there. But what I want you to know, God's going to take people in this nation and impact the whole world.
I love you people. I feel your love. I feel your burden, your compassion. Now, as your superintendent said, take it to the world. God's done something in us so that we can manifest him to the world. Hallelujah. Let's go in the name of Jesus. With those of you who aren't standing yet, would you stand with me? Let's just call it. Hallelujah. 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 This is the last time that I'm speaking. If you want to come and pray and call upon the Lord and give yourself afresh to him, please come in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 You come to Romoko Hoshikia. Oh, you have an anointing upon you. Lord Jesus, right now, I release that anointing to move upon this congregation. Let them go forth in the power of the Spirit with the anointing of God's Word. Hallelujah. Let them take the blood of Jesus that they might go and conquer. I ask that the wall of fire would surround them as they go forth with faith in the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He cut a little of the Hosha. He a little of the Hosha. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise
Yeah.
nakaranas ng isang sabi mga problema, mga pagsuko. Habang tayo ay gumagawa sa kalooban ng Diyos. Huwag po tayong matakot. Huwag po tayong manghina. There is a wall of fire. Hallelujah. Kasama po natin ang ating Panginoong Jesus. Sabi po niya, hindi po tayo niya babayaan. Hindi po tayo niya iba. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Palakpakan po natin.